us when we say we're able to, we are two of them. So we have to sometimes talk about the differences and where the disconnects happen, and whether it can be agreed or disagreed, but at least those disconnects have to be open. And one of them could be two examples that come to mind that's already been mentioned. One is patriarchy, and not just in Muslim, but also in Islam's own conception of itself. And the other one is, we made a particular mention of homosexuality, right? I would say that's a disconnect between, from my understanding of Islam, that it's conservatism in terms of how it views homosexuality. So, and in Canada, we've come to a historical moment where minorities are respected and valued. And so how as Muslim, Canadian Muslims, we talk about these issues?
Okay, so when it comes to the religion of Islam, yes, God tells us we don't have absolute autonomy in certain matters. So when it comes to those matters, as Muslims or as Canadians or as humans, we cannot make the decision. For example, euthanasia, to give yourself death. This is forbidden in Islam. Even if you are suffering due to a medical condition, I do not have absolute autonomy in making the decision to take my own life from an Islamic point of view. So there are certain boundaries, there are certain limits. And if there's a Canadian Muslim who would like to respect those limits and they want to practice their Islam with those limits, in a Canadian context, they have to be respected. We have freedom of religion. Yes, there are some Muslims that may not respect those limits and those boundaries. And again, being in a democratic society where everyone is free to make their choice, they are free to disregard those boundaries and those limits and make those their own decisions. But in general, when it comes to aspects of Islam, in fact, you put the Canadian Charter of Rights on one side and the Quran on the other, you will see that everything that is mentioned on the Charter is actually mentioned in the Holy Quran. Freedom of religion, freedom of mobility, respecting one another. These are all things that are mentioned in the Holy Quran. So many things, in fact, majority of the things, they do coincide with Canadian values, which we would call Canadian values. Yes, there are a few things that can be contentious, but when it comes to the community, we may, you know, this is the perspective I take, you know, dislike the sin, not the sinner, right? So someone may disagree with the concept of Islam that is very clear in the Quran, but it doesn't mean that he or she is not welcome in my mosque. He or she is not able to come and contribute in the community, in the society. He or she is not, able to say that I'm a Muslim. No, you know, embrace everyone how they are. As an Islamic leader, it's my job to encourage and teach the framework of Islam. And if someone doesn't respect it or doesn't want to adhere to it, that's fine. It's with them. But yes, I do agree. We can't always be saying that, you know what, this is what Islam allows and everything is allowed and everything is flexible. Yes, there are some limits and they have to be talked about when it comes to certain matters, right? So I do agree with that, that we can't hide what is actually in the Quran or what is actually considered our values and our teachings.
Well, a couple of things, and I think all of this conversation, personally for me as Muslim leaders, leaders who are involved in the community on the ground as well as, you know, in our boardrooms, I think it really comes down to two things, and that is our moral responsibility. One is the issue of inclusion, and second thing is accommodation. Sometimes we are unable to really, articulate what first and even visualize what inclusion means because we haven't experienced those lived experiences. Like we don't have that wealth of lived experiences on our decision making boards and our decision making tables and so on. So that's one thing. That's inclusion, but the inclusion. But the second part is accommodation, which is the real more practical part, and that is the more practical aspect of everything that all the controversies that we've been talking about for the last few minutes, controversies in a sense, I know, in a positive way, I would say, which is that we need to, a Muslim community, alhamdulillah, you know, by the grace of God, is now moving toward creating space for people of all sorts of orientations and ideas and, you know, backgrounds and ethnicities. And we're getting there. You know, it's a matter of time. It's what I call, you know, people always complain about, well, we don't have unity, we have this, we have that, we have this problem, that problem. The way I look at it is that this part of growing pains of the Muslim community, just like any community, minority community, immigrant community, has gone through, and they're still going through those pains. So it's a matter of time. So yes, while I can have my faith that can be both internal, very private, but at the same time very public, because Islam is at the same time also very public faith. All four out of five you know, pillars of Islam have very explicit, very direct social you know, aspect and social angle to it. So yes, we are going to be public as well. But what that religiosity would look like would differ for everybody. The extent of it, the you know, the taste of it, everything. And one of the conversation spaces, one of the places where we are all constantly having this tough conversation about creating spaces for all sorts of people in the Muslim community and as well as the wider community, interfaith community, is where I come from, Muslim Fest. This is an ongoing conversation there. You know, they're already on the, when you're talking about liberalism, artists, young in general, by nature, are already very liberal. And there, you have all sorts of strands of artists who are coming out who want to use their art to express not only themselves, but also talk about very complex issues that you're just trying to talk about today, and trying to navigate through their personal, through their artistic talent, those very, very difficult issues. And our job has been and still will be, how do you create spaces, right places, for those to be articulated, for those our talents to be showcased. And the similar conversation now we're having in the organization that we're in, very diverse. We have three converts, we have white, black, and anyone in between. We have young and old, very vibrant board that we currently have at ISNA, just got elected 3 months ago. And these are the conversations now we're having about women's inclusion and all sorts of anything else, any type of taboo topic that you could imagine is happening there. And we launched a campaign called Isma Listens, because one of the problems I've been hearing about for ages was nobody listens in our you know, community structures and religious structures. So we said, okay, let's launch these, you know, again, create those spaces for people to, for us to hear. And you'll hear all sorts of things that we may not be comfortable with, but just remember that Canadian Islam cannot be identified, it's not a monolith, cannot be you know, simplified and reduced to one version that just looks like me. There are going to be hundreds of people with the same name as mine, perhaps, who look probably very, very different from what I am.
You have a question?
Yeah, it's not a question, it's a comment. I'm going to make some point, because I don't know if you know, in Canada, the French were first before the English, but they had to fight. They had to fight to get a place. If you study in Ontario, you know, there, it was very difficult. And one thing sometimes I ask people who are the new Canadian to go to study in Canada, to go to see how, because for you, you work, there is a structure, governmental structure. I worked as evaluating textbook to get racism or stereotype out of textbook. Those things were being done in the government of Ontario because I was working here. You know, there are all kinds of things being done. You don't have problem because the structure, you have the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedom. So if you know some stupid people tell you, you know, I don't think that's going to pass. You know? And one thing that I can say also, there is an attitude in the Muslim community to see the other one as the infidel or the, you know, inferior. There is a kind of, I don't know if it's a big
pride within the Muslim community to see us. When I came to Toronto, police were killing black people as almost every day. But now it's kind of not every day or maybe every month. That's what I mean is, there is progress. And you cannot, when you say you're Somalian because of the food, but you have to eat some of this other food too. And you have to go to the community. You know, you have to be open, to welcome, because most people are nice. And then we have the law that protects us. We have, you are talking about the Canadian Charter of Rights. Go to it, Multiculturalism Act. I have those books, you know, that's when you go, you can get them for free. So you don't have really a problem. You know, if someone doesn't like your things, but it's beautiful, but that's okay. After that person sees it for 100 times, if it still doesn't like it, that's his business. So we have to learn to see the problem where they are. And not to take little things to make problem with them. If I go to your home, you give me food, I'm hungry, I'm going to eat. You know? And most food is food. So you have to, you know, like before, I was teaching geography when they're talking about the First Nation as savages. But those books are out. And there were a lot of effort being made across Canada in terms of structure, in terms of government, for those things to disappear. Maybe you would have some difficulty to find a job to begin with, or sometimes the secretary has her own things and it doesn't answer you the way it's supposed, but it's not the structure. So that's where we have to get things, because you know, Canada is a great country.
Thank you so much for your comments, ma'am. I really appreciate those. Any more questions? You look like you want to ask a question. No? No questions?
Well, I have.
Yeah, go ahead.
Slightly different context, moving on perhaps the question raised here on the elephant in the room. A number of months ago, as part of a conversation with a man called Elias Mallon, who's a Catholic priest, visited in New York. He works at the UN, he's an expert in Catholic, about Muslim relations, works around the world. This conversation was with Imam Habib Wali. And it was quite an interesting conversation. And the point that Elias raised to Imam Habib was one of the issues, and obviously there's a lot of, when it comes to extremes, but a lot of issues globally, and we have nothing, it's not to oversimplify this, but the issue he was focusing on was that one of the problems he sees is that when it comes to people, you know, a bad attack happening, and everyone says, oh, it's a terrorist attack, it's ISIS, it's Daesh, is that Islamic leadership, recognizing Islam is not a monolithic organization structure like Catholicism, is that a lot of leadership, not just Muslim, but others, are saying, well, you know, ISIS or Daesh, they are not practicing Muslims, they're not good Muslims. They're not basing it in the theology or religion. And the point Elias made, and I have your comments on this, was until certain leadership within Islam, recognizing that there are roots, even if the individuals are claiming them, and other Muslims are not seeing those roots. And the parallel he made was the Catholic Church finally embraced anti-Semitism within the Catholic Church. And it wasn't until they embraced it that anti-Semitism grew from Catholicism or from Christianity, they could start to address it. So the point he made was, certain Islamic individual leadership has to say, unfortunately, this is where the roots, and we have to embrace it internally. So I'm wondering what your thoughts are on that.
I'm just going to address the comments that were made earlier, but I think that what it boils down to be grateful at where we are, and fully Ukrainian. I don't think at any point there was a comment that was made about not being grateful for all the good things that it means to be a Canadian, but also part of that conversation of being a Canadian is doing that self-reflection and understanding what's our shortcomings. One of the teachings that we have as Muslims is that every night before you go to bed, you're supposed to hold yourself accountable for your held accountable. That means taking an account of your day's work, your week's work every Friday. You know, when we go to Friday prayers, we're supposed to be reflective on our how our week went. Who did we harm? Who did we help? What words that we have used? What shortcomings? What sins maybe we have committed knowing or unknowingly, and seeking for forgiveness? And not only seeking for forgiveness, but also correcting any of those things. So 100%, that is part of the recognition of all the people who, all the generations that came before us, whether they are, whether I am direct descent, so my mother and my grandmother and great-grandmother, for the rights I have as a Somali woman, I owe all those to that. And as a black woman who became black when I was 16 and I came to Canada, and that label was placed on me, I didn't choose to become a black woman, but I am a black woman right now, right? I do recognize the generations of black people that came before me and the rights that they had to fight. So I can be a senior consultant at a, you know, at a provincial level. So it took many generations and a lot of other people for people to be able to walk into a room and for my credentials and my knowledge to be recognized and not to be dismissed because I'm a woman, because I wear hijab, because I'm a black person. So while we recognize all those things, we cannot also just sit in a place of complacency and think that, you know, we have it good, I made it, that's good, right? And not recognize that I often give this analogy of saying that there is a wall and there are very small cracks on those walls and few of us are able to go through. In my organization, I'm only one of very, very few black people. I'm definitely the only black person in my department of 400 people. And I'm definitely the only person. Often, and Naheed and I were having these conversations, I'm often given opportunities to sit in places where I'm the only, you know, visible person in that room that is non-European descent. So recognizing that, I can give myself a shoulder, you know, pat on the shoulder and say, good job, Sam, yeah, you made it. But the rest of the people who look like me are, you know, stuck behind that wall. So our conversations we're having today, and we often have these conversations, is how do we change those cracks on the walls to doors? That then young generations after us, regardless of their faith or, you know, their background and their identity, can walk through that if they want it and if they work for it. So I think that is, it's important to recognize how can we make the world a better place for everybody, not only people who self-identify as Muslim or as Somali or as black, right?
I just want to answer the lady's comments there. Every religion has roots to extremism. You have Catholics and Christians who bomb abortion clinics almost every other month. And the problem is within the religion and a misunderstanding of that religion. So I agree, there are roots within the Islamic teachings that if they are not understood properly, they can be misused or misinterpreted to engage in doing inappropriate activities and then justified using those verses or those teachings. So yes, there are roots and the Muslim community has been addressing them. A simple example is Sheikh Umar Suleiman. He has an institute known as Yaqeen Institute, and he's been taking with his organization the difficult discussions found in the Muslim texts and giving the proper context and the interpretation for a North American or a European crowd to understand that what does jihad actually mean? And how can I still practice jihad without it being understood as something like violence which causes harm to others? So there are roots, and the Muslim community is embracing these challenges to make the difficult conversations and clarifying wherever it needs to be done.
I think we've come to the end. We're actually 1 minute short of coming to the end. I just wanted to thank the panelists. Thank you so much for taking time out and for coming here. And thank you to all of you for listening and for sharing and for thinking and engaging and asking some wonderful questions. We have a few minutes for people to mingle a little bit. So if you want to, if you have a question you were kind of shy about asking or you wanted to come up and ask, that'd be great.
There's also some refreshments still at the back if you want to partake in that. First time, second time, third time, whatever you like. And also, I guess, right, so there will also be an opportunity to pray in the bunker here. That's what we're going to be doing, so we need to stick around for that. And thank you so much for coming. It was great.